Hello and welcome to NewsX India A-List. For over 2 years now, we have been committed to getting you the best from various fields, be it entertainment, technology, business or social work. Today, we have yet another episode lined up for you in which we speak to some of India's finest. Our first interview is with the stars of Modern Love Mumbai. Designer and actor Masaba Gupta and actor Hitvik Bhoumik join us to share their journey and the series. The second interview is with a leader in thought and business, the CTO and founder of Trucknetic, Arham Pratap Jain. And last but not the least, the voice behind hit Bollywood songs such as Rapta and Naach Meri Rani, Nikita Gandhi. Listen in.
Winning over India with their new series.
I'm very happy with the reviews. I will take all my time to soak it in for life, and I will never forget this.
They're the Modern Love Mumbai stars.
I just got lucky that Dhruv auditioned me for Parth's part, and later when I got the part, I also read the entire script.
NewsX proudly recognizes Masaba Gupta and Hitvik Bhoumik for excellence in entertainment.
Hello and welcome. I'm Udaya Pratap Singh. You're joining us on this special episode of NewsX India A-List. We are in conversation today with two very special individuals who've just got a lot of rave reviews for their latest project called Modern Love Mumbai. I am talking about Masaba Gupta and Hitvik Bhoumik. So welcome both of you to NewsX. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.
Masaba, let me come to you first. As I told you earlier, before we started, special studio, special look for a special project of yours and the first full-fledged acting role of yours as well. You have, of course, done a previous series, but you were playing yourself. So I think I'm going to call this pretty much your acting debut. Yes. So how was it? Firstly, you know, saying yes, what appealed to you? And now that all the reviews have poured in, what's the feeling like?
I mean, firstly, I'm just glad this happened because I almost thought I would lose the film. No one knows this, but I got COVID about 3-4 days just before we had to start filming. And my face was this big, swollen. And I was convinced that, you know, the production house and everyone will just go with someone else, because I know we had a timeline as to when it had to release, given that it's an anthology, right? So I was very prepared. I did my crying for one whole day and everything while I was sick. But I guess it was meant to be there. You know, I think that when I read the script, of course, there was initially, I didn't really understand what world Saiba and Parth come from, only because I'm not somebody who belongs to that world myself as an individual. I'm not on a dating app. I haven't been on serial dates, I guess. So, you know, there's all those things and I just don't come from that world. But the more I met Dhruv and the more we did, I did an audition for him over Zoom, which was special because I don't know why I love auditions. It's crazy. It's like I'm addicted to auditions.
Yeah.
I take it up as a challenge and I want to, you know, always do my best. But I think just the fact that it was such a simple story about love, it wasn't heavy, it was meaningful. And at the same time, it was being done by somebody who I admire, because I think the way Dhruv has handled little things, you can see that he has a flair for something that hasn't really been touched upon by a lot of filmmakers, and I think he's got this eye for the world, which is very different. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I ever went in thinking that, oh my God, this is going to be a huge success, or this is going to make, you know, like launch me as an actor. But I went in thinking, you know what? It'll be meaningful. And I know that I will be able to do justice to it. So that was it. You know, my gut said that it's the right thing to do. And I did it right after Masaba. So it was quite something.
Yeah. And now with the reviews pouring in, what's the feeling like? First reviews as an actor for you. Also, I have to ask you what your mother said as well. Typical question.
My mother has said, you've got my gene now. Can you believe it? I mean, this is... So my mother and I have this thing, right? We don't hug all the time. We're not very cuddly. But after she saw the film, she said, I must give you a hug. And that for me was a huge compliment. And I think that more than that, I must say that, even I was telling Hitvik this as well, that She said, "You're amazing and you have so much to also learn from Ritwik," which I thought is a compliment to him as well, because she said, "Look, has this stillness." It was like she said, "You both are basically, there was a fight, the energy, the chemistry was between you, that was between you was stillness." Mm-hmm. Usually it's like, you know, it's always somewhat sexual or somewhat, you know, it's like texting or intimate or whatever. She said the fact that you both are just yourselves and that you're still is, was very nice. So she also thought that because Ritwik was doing what he was doing opposite me, I could do a better job. So it was great. And I'm very happy with the reviews. I will take all my time to soak it in for life. And I will never forget this moment.
Okay. Let me get in Ritwik as well at this point. I remember not too long back, actually, in similar COVID times and virtual mode, we were doing an interview with you as well for your debut film, which was interestingly also, debut series also on Amazon Prime, of course. And, you know, so from then to now, what all has changed, Ritwik? We saw you the other day. I was in Mumbai seeing you perform with Madhuri Dixit. I'm sure very special feeling for you as well on stage that day. From then to now, what all has changed? You know, what appealed to you about Model Love Mumbai? Again, a romantic story, but very different, of course, from your last outing. So what convinced you to say yes, and what all has changed since then?
I don't know what has changed. One for sure, what has changed is the quality of work coming my way, you know, and the kind of scripts I get to read are very exciting. And every time I read them, and if I like them, I feel like, how did they think of me? Then I'm like, okay, that's a rubbish thought. Let's move on. Let's just find out if we're going to do this or not. But yeah, other than that, nothing has changed. I feel I was happy then. I'm happy now. I'm very happy. I'm getting to do good work. And what made me say yes about Modern Love Mumbai? Firstly, I'm a huge fan of Modern Love, the show that was made earlier, Stories of New York, Stories of England. And I've loved the episodes that they've made before. So I always wanted to be a part of something like this. So when Modern Love came my way, I definitely wanted to be associated with it. I just got lucky that Dhruv auditioned me for Parth's part. And later when I got the part, I also read the entire script. And I was sold. I was absolutely sold. Firstly, I thought Dhruv is a very intelligent and a very well-spoken man, because I had only spoken to him on the phone. Mm-hmm. And according to the instructions he was giving me on the phone, I was recording my audition. And thankfully, he liked the test. And thankfully, he got me on board, because I got to read a script like this, which is so pure, so nice, so simple, and yet so beautiful. And yeah, then I was sold. Modern Love Mumbai, one of the finest scripts I've read. It wasn't a tough decision.
No doubt. Yes. And, you know, also, of course, this connect with OTT, what explains it for you? Is it just something that's happened, something planned? How do you explain this for yourself and your career trajectory?
I've never had a plan. I'm the guy with no plan. I've never, ever had a plan. Everything has just happened to me. And that's why I really consider myself to be lucky. But I've always been told, even as a child in my growing years, by most people that I knew and people that I looked up to, that for your luck to work, you've got to work hard. So when for your chance, when the luck arrives, you've got to be prepared. So I've just been preparing aimlessly for what I don't know. I'm preparing. I'm constantly in the grind. And when projects like this happen is when I get to know. Probably it was because of this.
Okay. Masaba, do we see more of you now in films, in web series, in acting performances? Or is this something you can't plan and you're going to wait and see how it goes?
You know, I definitely want to do more. I've tasted blood, as they say. You know, it's an addictive experience, and I definitely want to do more. But what I'm very clear about is that I will only do things that are meaningful. You know, I keep saying meaningful, but it really, it's a cliche, and it's true that, you know, acting and just being in front of a camera on a set is such a physical thing. Mm-hmm. You know, it's almost exhausting to a point, and it should be worth my time. And it should be worth my time enough that it takes me away from my business for those couple of days, because I love my business too much. It's my first baby. So it should have enough of an impact in my life for me to do something. But I just hope people are able to view me outside of Masaba, which is why I'm so grateful for Dhruv, right? Because it's so easy to get caught and say, oh my God, but she's herself, you know? Mm-hmm. Plus, I'm on Instagram. Plus, I'm like every, you know, doing something or the other. So, I'm so public in that sense. That I think people should be able to view me as something else. Like, I wish people can view me as a cop from Raipur, then I would have done my job, you know, as an example. So I'm saying that now what I want to do is I want to start working on my, what I'll do every weekend, I was thinking, is that I'll start working on different dialects. I'll start working on different looks that, that people view me in. And that's my work. That's my meditation. Yeah. And if someone picks it up, great.
Well, since you did talk about, you know, your business and your brand, I have to quickly ask you, you know, because we've often spoken to actors about this, and OTT has been one big change, you know, in this post-COVID era. For the fashion industry, for your brand, and for, you know, fashion in general, what do you believe has changed, you know, post-COVID, and you believe will be a defining trend going forward for the industry?
You know, what's really, really changed? I was doing a meeting this morning with my team, and we were talking about the fact that everyone has suddenly had a very inward journey through COVID, right? You're starting to think about, what does my house look like? Like, is this couch even comfortable? You know, what, where is the dal that I eat coming from? You know, where is this shirt that I'm wearing coming from? Who's making it? So I think everyone's become very aware, conscious as a consumer. Consumers have become extremely sharp. So I think the idea is that we have to constantly, I think the fashion industry has never had to be on their toes more than now. At the same time, I think we're noticing that different world economies are opening up. You know, there was so much of reliability on China, dependence on China for certain things. Today, we're seeing so many different parts of the world fulfill that. We're also seeing that we have to be fluid, adapt to things in our approach to business. Because the thing is, you plan for 5 years and then suddenly 3 months later, you're locked up for 2 years and you don't know what to do with your business, you know. So I think... I've just discovered that fashion, every label, every brand, every entrepreneur will have to decide that they can adapt. They are fluid in their business plans. They're fluid in the way they approach their businesses. And they're also very, very aware, conscious of what they're doing, what kind of carbon footprint their brand has. Many things, you know, I think it's just about awareness today and not putting the consumer anymore.
Okay. Well, final question now to both of you. I have to ask you, because I must say this as well, you know, I've been reading a lot of reviews and a lot of you know, talk about the entire series, and I think your particular episode has got a lot of love, so congratulations on that, and congratulations to Dhruv as well, the captain of your small ship in this anthology. Do you guys love Thane? You know, I know that's the title of your show, but
do love
there
Thane
very often in real life. Do you love it in real life as well? Do you love Thane?
We better love Thane, huh? I mean, I am moving. I better move to Thane. But yeah, it, I have to say, when we shot there, it was beautiful. Yeah. Surprisingly green. Surprisingly, just so much space. Very nice. Okay.
Ritvik?
I have always loved Thane. I've always loved Thane. I was in love with Thane. In love with Thane. I grew up there, hence. I think finally, after this short film that we've made, I think Thane's loved us back too. So I think it's Thane telling us that Thane loves us.
It's a mutual admiration relationship. Okay, well, a lot of love to you all, of course. So congratulations on that. And I'm sure you do deserve it as well. Modern love, Mumbai. So modern love coming in for both of you and of course the show. So thank you so much for joining us once again and wishing you all the very best in your trajectory going forward as well.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.
A one-stop shop for all your trucking needs.
We have very small trucks like Maruti Eco to heavy-duty trucks. We do B2C to B2B. We are in intra-city to interstate.
He's the driving force behind Trucknetic.
So Trucknetic essentially is Uber for trucks today, where we are one-stop solution for all kind of trucks in the country.
NewsX proudly recognizes Arham Pratap Jain for excellence in business leadership.
Hello and welcome. I'm Uday Pratap Singh. You're joining us on this special edition of NewsX A-List. We are in conversation today with Arham Pratap Jain. He is founder and chief trucking officer for Trucknetic. Welcome, Arham, to the show. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Uday. Thank you for the introduction. Pleasure to be here.
Begin by talking about your venture, Trucknetic. Firstly, tell us about, you know, what was the idea behind the company, what its objective is, what led you to found it in 2019, if I'm not mistaken, And also the name, because the name is also pretty catchy. So how did you come up?
Sure. So it happened to be by accident. So, you know, I have started my career as a social entrepreneur, straight out of mechanical engineering, you know, after completion. Stayed there for a couple of years and then was in the sector for about 3 to 4 years where I did multiple global fellowships outside India in UK, US, joined a company. And then, you know, I sort of transitioned my career into investment banking and did that for about 2.5, 3 years. Then I was like, okay, you know, what's next? Because, you know, I wasn't enjoying the job scenario for safe and safe thing. I always wanted to be an entrepreneur and run my own business. So I joined a family business, which was primarily into trading. So trading of chemicals, energy, and other sort of commodities where we were doing import and exports. So trading is closely related to logistics. And that was the first time that I got exposed to, you know, the logistics market in the country.
Okay.
So we ourselves in the group were facing a lot of problems in procuring the vehicles on the outside market when it comes to road transportation, trucks and stuff. So that kind of, you know, make me sort of think, you know, what's wrong in the industry? Why nobody has been able to look into the industry the way it is? And, you know, it's quite a sort of, you know, a challenging industry that, you know, it's going on for last 200, 300 years and nothing has been changed the way it was. And it took me to kind of, you know, put my thinking hat on, and I took a sabbatical after a year in the business. Okay. For 3 months and started interacting with a lot of stakeholders, starting from people who were, who have trucks, like, you know, fleet owners, transporters, small, medium, you know, enterprises, corporates, and started to make sense of the entire ecosystem and figured that, you know, there are a lot of problems in the industry. There's a lot of white space. There's a lot of challenges. There's the entire supply chain is more, you know, sort of expensive because a lot of stakeholders are involved, which aren't putting any sort of value into the system, just making the money off the side, whereas both the fleet owners and the end customer are getting exploited. So that's how I jumped into this and started the company in September 2019. When it comes to the name, you know, I got the name at 3 a.m. in the morning while I was sleeping. I just got up and, you know, just felt like, you know, to buy this domain name Trucknetic with the idea of, you know, so if the name, you know, if you break down the name, it is truck plus kinetic, which means a truck should always be in motion with a kinetic energy.
Okay.
So it echoed with the purpose because that's what we wanted to do with the company as well, where we would want every truck to be in the motion all the time because that's what they are for, rather than kind of, you know, stranding and kind of, you know, not being in the action. And that's why I got the name. So Trucknetic essentially is Uber for trucks today, where we are one-stop solution for all kind of trucks in the country. We have very small trucks like Maruti Eco to heavy-duty trucks. We do B2C to B2B. We are in intra-city to interstate. Any person, individual, or corporate or government, anybody who wants truck, they can come to our platform. So that's it is. We have reduced the lead time substantially from 2 days to 30 minutes to 3 hours. We have been able to kind of reduce the freight cost for the shippers because at the back end, we are using high-end technology such as artificial intelligence, machine learning, and other automation software to reduce the cost to the shipper to kind of bring down the cost of logistics in the country, which is very high, which is around 18% of GDP as compared to 8 to 10% globally. So there's a delta of around 6 to 8%. Every single year, we are losing close to $45 billion because of a demand-supply mismatch. And that's what the made us to kind of think that, okay, let's just solve the problem of return load at the back end. And at the front end, let's become a one-stop solution for all kind of trucks.
Okay.
So this is what we are doing.
Yeah. And you know, you often talk about the return load model. So just describe a bit for our viewers, what is this return load model that your company follows?
So we have a proprietary technology to solve the problem of return load. Last year, Microsoft kind of got interested and put in some money as well. And they have opened up their systems, Microsoft Azure AI platform, to help us out. And their team is also helping us to make a proof of concept to kind of solve the problem of return load in a real time using the demand forecasting model. Mm-hmm. So return load typically there is a problem that is there, not just in trucking market, but in every mobility industry. Mm-hmm. Uber, why we call ourselves Uber for trucks is because Uber or Olas of the world have been able to crack the problem of return load. The only thing that they are capturing as a KPI is how they can reduce the freight
you know, without, you know, reduce the wastage of miles without freight. And that's what we have been doing. So what we are doing is, for example, if a truck is coming from Bombay to Delhi, so we are providing the shippers, the end customers who are based out of Delhi, those trucks without the broker. Because what used to happen that, you know, if supposedly the freight component from Bombay to Delhi is around 1,000 rupees.
Yeah.
So the fleet owner used to make only 200 to 300 rupees while going back, where they were incurring the same cost of diesel and all overhead expenses, because the broker was taking that sort of a margin, because the customer based out of Delhi was only paying 1,000 rupees. Okay. So, but the broker was making the chunk of the money, which is around 70%, which is normal. So what we are doing is we have been able to directly connect with the shippers both ways, the end customers. Mm-hmm. So as soon as, and we do have all technology, right? So as soon as the truck reaches to Delhi, we have a geofencing technology through which we send the push notification to relevant MSMEs, mm-hmm. who would be able to kind of carry, provide the load for the same truck type. Mm-hmm. So we have done that truck type to commodity mapping. We have done all the lanes mapping, all the toll taxes sort of a mapping. We have figured the inbound and outbound movements of the companies that we work. Yes. And then we have an option on our application where, you know, the companies can put up their orders in advance for 30 days, which helps us to know the idea of the movement of, you know, those companies in advance. So we can place the trucks according to them. And on the top of it, we have an AI and ML model to kind of solve this problem in a much better way with more accuracy and in real time.
And you do have pretty well-known companies that you are already working with. So I want to get to also, you know, since you are a startup venture, how was it, you know, getting funding initially as well? How did you go about that process? How was the response? And also, what's the growth been since when you started it till today in 2022?
I mean, like, the growth has really, really accelerated. I mean, like, to be very honest today, I mean, like, we started just before COVID. Mm-hmm. But it was a blessing in disguise, because with COVID, people have started accepting the digital platform like ours, because they have seen that, you know, like, the business can be disrupted and they have to think, you know, out of box to kind of maintain the businesses, because the businesses were very scarce in those times, because most of the things were halted, specifically during the lockdowns. When it comes to the funding, I mean, like, I have put in all my savings in the beginning, and then, you know, the one that I have accumulated by investment banking or the companies that I've ran before and stuff. Then, you know, we also got some awards money, as well as, you know, we have got some grants from the companies, you know, who helped us to kind of, you know, accelerate. When it comes to a growth, we started off pretty slow. Like, we did a revenue in FY20 of 1 crore. Then in FY21, we moved to 9 crores. And then in FY22, we did close to 16 crores. And in FY23, with the God's grace, we'll be able to do close to 300 crores in revenue. We already have got a 100 crores commitment. We have done major tie-ups with multiple brands and big startups as well. So the growth will be quite exponential in that sense. We are also in the midst of a Series A round, where we are raising close to $10 million. We already have got some commitment around that, and looking out to close that fund by July this year.
Okay.
The idea is we already have close to 2 lakh fleet owners with us, 50,000 transporters, which gives us a visibility of close to 1 million trucks, which is 10 lakh trucks, out of 12 million trucks in the country. So with in next 2 years, with the funding, we're going to be able to kind of ramp up our trucks from 1 million to 3 million. And would be able to cater to close to 10 lakh, you know, carriers, and close to 1 lakh MSMEs and businesses.
Okay, great. Well, you also won quite a few awards along the way. Last question now, because we've run pretty much out of time. What's the growth looking like? What's the future looking like? Is there a lot of potential? Do you already have a lot of plans for the way forward for Trucknetic?
I mean, like, you know, we do have a very sort of a, you know, good plan when it comes to going forward. The idea is by 2025, we want to become the biggest company in trucking without owning a single truck, where we would want to become that option that anybody for any kind of purpose wants truck, just download our application and get the truck through our platform.
Yeah.
So that is what we are looking to envisage. It's a very big industry, logistics. By 2021, it was close to $215 billion. I think in next 4 to 5 years, it's going to move from $215 to $330 billion opportunity. So it's a massive market, and 95-96% of the market is still, you know, is running by those unorganized players. So there's a huge potential for us, and let's see how the journey would be. It's a beautiful journey so far, and we would want to kind of, you know, have the similar journey going forward as well.
Okay, well, wishing you and you know, everyone at Trucknetic all the very best, Aram, for the journey ahead. Thank you so much for joining us today on NewsX.
Thanks a lot, Uday. Thanks for giving us the opportunity to speak to you today.
From top hits like Rabta to Kafirana.
This song just kind of just happened. Bacha, he messaged me, he said that, you know, we need to do another track together, and he just randomly sent me the song.
She's the voice behind Bollywood chart toppers.
I was awesome. I think the video is killer, and I'm so happy to be part of it.
NewsX proudly presents Nikita Gandhi for Excellence in Entertainment.
Hello, welcome. I'm Uday Pratap Singh. You're joining us on a brand new episode of NewsX India A-List. We are in conversation today with well-known singer Nikita Gandhi. Nikita, welcome to NewsX. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Let me begin by talking to you about your recent releases, both of which are really killing it for, of course, Kangana Ranaut in Dhakar, and also Modern Love Mumbai, a series that's getting a lot of love and a lot of praise. So let's start out by talking a bit about Dhakar. Is it the first time you're singing for Kangana in a film? And how was the experience? And how was the response to the songs?
It is the first time I'm singing for her. And I've been a fan of her work, her acting, since Queen especially. And this song just kind of just happened. Bacha, he messaged me, he said that, you know, we need to do another track together, and he just randomly sent me the song, and then his team called me and he's like, by the way, you're singing for Kangana for Dhakar, and it just kind of like fell into place. And yeah, it was awesome. I think the video is killer, and I'm so happy to be a part of it.
Okay, also Modern Love Mumbai, you know, again, singing for an OTT platform, firstly, how was that, you know, a web series, and also you know, I mean, a short film anthology, and also, you know, for a love track, you know, for a very soothing and very, you know, interesting track, of course, for this anthology of love stories. How was that?
Firstly, I think I want to say that I'm really happy that Amazon Prime is promoting the music. I think a lot of great music gets lost on OTT.
Yeah.
And it, because we are in the transition period where, you know, people, there's more OTT happening, but the music is kind of in a confused space because it's not reaching the streaming platforms and people, and there's so much good music that has come through OTT, but it's not really got its true due, you know, in terms of just the audience being able to consume that music. And I think it's great that they're promoting the show through the music, and they've made videos for each song with us and with the montages of the show. And I think that's one of the reasons I love being a part of this. And the second reason is, of course, Ram Sampath.
Yeah.
I'm a big fan of his music, and I'm so glad that I finally, you know, got to tick that from my bucket list, because I think one of the songs, Katte was a song that I was obsessed with from Coke Studio or MTV, one of the two. And I loved it so much that I used to sing it. I mean, I still do sing it in some of my shows.
Yeah.
So even though it's a non-film record. And so, like, I'm a big fan of his, and so happy that I got to share a song with him. And the song is lovely. When I reached Calcutta, I'm in Calcutta today and starting my India tour.
Yes.
And when I landed, and the FM was playing in the car, and Raat Rani started playing. And my mom was like, yeah, they play it every day, like 3-4 times at least. So I'm so happy that the music is reaching the audience.
Okay. Would you like to sing a line or two from either of Raat Rani or Dhakar?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Dil pe na curfew hai mere khwabon ke na bandishe raat ki paabandiyon ko tod ke main khil gayi main raat rani ki kali main raat rani Marat Rani ki kali, Marat Rani. Oh.
Fantastic. Thank you for that. But, you know, coming to your India tour now, as you're saying, you know, you've landed already in Kolkata for it.
Yes.
It's all set to begin. So how's the feeling, you know, going on an India tour once again after, you know, this very turbulent time that we've had? Oh, wow. Fantastic.
This is the first tour.
And what timing? What timing? You know, just as the new normal is starting again, just as things are, you know, have opened up and going back to normal again. So how's the feeling like? And also starting it out from a city which is obviously very close to your heart.
Yes, I love how it's sort of the journey of my tour is also kind of synonymous with my life, because it starts from Kolkata, where I'm from, where I've been born and raised, and then I'm going to a couple of cities. Then the second last one is in Chennai, which is where I spent my college time and where I started my music career.
Okay.
And ends with Bombay, which is where I live now. So I think it's very in tune with my life's journey, and I'm so happy that my first tour is and I have a lot of unique music to offer. I'm trying my best to just do my music.
Okay.
I know that's that can be tricky, because you need to keep people entertained and you keep need to, you know, have like bangers. But thankfully, a lot of my songs are bangers. So I'm excited. I think like 80 to 90% of my set is just my music.
Fantastic.
So just so happy to bring that vision.
Yeah. No, amazing that you've managed that kind of discography already in your career. And I'm sure there are a lot of songs left for you to give us and offer us. But, you know, just talking about now these last 2 years, Nikita, how has it been for you? You know, very, very difficult time, very turbulent time, a time when, you know, suddenly everyone was at home for very, very long periods during these lockdowns that we've seen. But for you, it's been productive as well, you know, because we've seen over the last couple of years, you had quite a few releases. So obviously you've been active and it's been professionally all right for you, would you say?
Financially, I mean, I don't want to talk. I think everyone's been financially hit, but I think creatively it was a beautiful time for me. I think I tried to stay as positive as possible and vent through my music, through my art, through just different canvases, whatever I could, you know, lay my hands on and thoughts on. So I think it, as an artist, it was a very therapeutic time, because I think it was important to spend that time in that way instead of dwelling over what's going to happen next, because I think we all were thinking that at the back of our minds. But there's only one way to move forward, and that's just to focus on the things you can do and things that are in your control. So my music was in my control, so I released a lot of music, a lot of big songs also released somehow during the course of the pandemic, be it Burj Khalifa or Nach Meri Rani. So I'm very grateful that I had access to music while I was locked at home in Bombay. So I think the music really got me through, and I think it was the same for my audience as well.
Yeah. And as we talk about this new normal, what are some changes that, you know, you've probably imbibed in your personality going ahead from these 2 years? And also, has the music industry changed, you believe, in a certain way going ahead after these 2 years, from some of the learnings?
The music industry has changed as we started this conversation with OTT. I think a lot has drifted towards OTT, and I think we are now reaching like an equilibrium where the music industry is sort of independent of the film industry and or getting there, which I think is a great change in our film diaspora, because it's important that artists have their own individual voice as opposed to just being the voice of somebody.
Yeah,
you know, so that's, I think, a beautiful journey that our industry is going through.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a significant change that we have seen. And it's given a platform to a lot of new artists who would not have had this platform otherwise.
Yeah. Okay. And also, you know, just talking now before we end about your career graph. So these days, of course, we've been seeing the IPL on television and, of course, live as well, as it's been happening. Interestingly, the last couple of matches were in Kolkata itself, the qualifiers and eliminator. But after every match, you know, there's an award given called Game Changer of the Match. You know, someone who's come and changed the course of the match for his or her team.
Right.
So for you, which has been a song you know, track that has been game changing for you? One, I can ask you to name one or two.
I think every song has its own significance in my journey. But just to specifically answer your question, the game changer, I think, hands down, was Jugnu. It blew up, and how. And I think it also empowered non-film music because it didn't have any film attached to it. So I think, and it also had a different sound. It wasn't a typical Badshah song also. So I think it was a game changer for him, for the industry, for me. And I am so happy I got to be, I mean, I think it was a game changer in general. Yeah. And so I'm so excited to be part of a game, an industry game changer, as opposed to just a game changer for myself. No doubt. Yeah, Jugnu, hands down.
And you've had many game changing tracks, as you're saying. Each song has, you know, its own shelf life and, of course, its own impact. So I would like you to sign off by singing perhaps one of the big game changing tracks for our viewers as well.
बादल भी दिखते मुझको दिल की शेप में हैप्पीनेस रहने लगी मेरी जेब में हारने में है मजा ये वो गेम है हालत जो है तेरी मेरी भी सेम है तेरी बातों में दिल खोश आ गया मेरी रातों में दिल होश आ गया प्यार कहते जिसको फाइनली वो होश आ गया फाइनली Finally, finally. I'm gonna leave it there because I think finally is a great cliffhanger.
Absolutely, absolutely. But finally, finally, your fans are going to be seeing you live in action at your India tour. So all the very best for that, Nikita. And as you said, you know, these are bangers. So I'm sure, you know, they're going to have a great time listening and dancing to these songs as well. So thank you so much and all the very best going ahead.
Thank you.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.